Oh, our cunning plan had one slight flaw in it, in that the lions decided that they weren't having any of it, and off they went into thick bush. So obviously Taylor's gone to the north, I've gone to the south, and both of us are scanning intently to see whether or not we can't pick up on where those lions have gone. I have a suspicion that that elephant trumpet that I heard earlier, more like a scream actually, was the elephants reacting to the lions. Although, usually when elephants chase predators like that, they usually react a little bit more strongly. Something on the ground here. What is that? A nightjar. Must be. Might be a nice idea to just sit and listen as well. There's the elephants up ahead somewhere. Oh, sorry. Sorry. I need to use the spotlight, Dave. I hear you, Elise. I just don't see you. Okay. I know there's elephants somewhere around here, I just can't see where they are. Copy that, thanks Taylor. Okay, so back to our little nightjar. Very, very cool. Probably a fiery necked, but not necessarily, and they are quite tricky, the nightjars. It's the tiniest, most subtle differences. You were there, yeah? The tiniest, most subtle of distinctions that determine which particular species of nightjar this is. It also gives us a good chance to listen to the sounds of the other animals. Perhaps something else spots the lions for us, giving us a chance to see them. Cool. Beautiful little birds. Let me show you quickly, since we are here, and I'm just waiting to listen. I want to just take the opportunity to listen. It's surprisingly difficult. I'm going to try and keep my shadow out of my way. Nightjar. Let's go to fiery necked. I hear you, elephants. I hear you. So, just to give you an example, nightjars kind of all look the same. This was a fiery necked nightjar. It definitely was. You might have noticed the lighter spots around the wings. And they're one of the most well-known sounds out here that I don't know how to do it. Pardon? Yes, it does, doesn't it? There we go, that's better. Isn't it?
Yes.
This is much better. Now that's one of the things that distinguishes it. It's meant to be saying, deliver us, in a beautiful song. It's the song I always associate with summer in the African bushveld. The other species that we get, I'm gonna just turn the page in a second. The other species that we get, Eurasian nightjar, also has similar but is slightly bigger than the fiery necked nightjar, as far as I know. Oh dear, sorry Dave. You must smack me on the back of the head. Sorry, that's my fault. It doesn't have the rufous collar that gives the fiery necked nightjar its name. And then those are the sort of the main two that we would get out here. I'm just trying to think if there's another one. Yes, there is another one, the square-tailed. And that's where it does get a little bit complicated. Because as you can see, very, very similar to the fiery neck that we were looking at. Now, I'm relatively certain it's a fiery necked, but I'm not 100% sure. Okay, we're going to continue on our search for these mysterious lions. In the meantime, James has had far more success. Mark, we still haven't relocated.
Well, everybody, there is Morana, the male lion. That's who we think he is anyway. And we think from our intel, we've been doing much intel gathering. I feel like the entire branch of MI6 We have been gathering intel, and we think that that is Morana, the brother of Scarface, that quite epic male lion we saw yesterday. He's stuck his head up, only because we came along, I'm afraid. But there he is, but next to him is one of the, I think, from what I can tell, one of the blonder males, one of the other males of the coalition that come in here and killed the cubs. And what's interesting is he's clearly young, he's got still a bit of pink on his nose. But what's interesting is that apparently Morana, when these blondies killed the cubs, for some time was seen with the cubs and spending time with them and their mothers. And he took no part in killing them, but he also obviously took no part in defending them while his brother Scarface was across the river. Perhaps he feels a sense of shame. No, he's a magnificent boy. Look at him. Jeepers, he's big. Yeah, no, it's not surprising that he is the brother. I think we should go to the thermal for this one. There we have the lion, and just behind him a little patch of warmth you can see on the thermal camera. And look how cool his mane is, A. And B, this is the lion we saw flicking his tail on the first night we did this, and he's got no pom-pom. And that's why his tail ends rather abruptly, as opposed to in a semi-dark pom-pom. That was an astounding thing to see. Oh, wonderful. Excellent. All right, let me just move slightly. Johnny, I'll try and get the front IR in on the sleepy one, other sleepy one, and the side one on the other sleepy one. There we are. Look at that. They've lain perfectly for our infrared lights. Let's go slightly closer and turn off here. In fact, we might try and go around the other side shortly. We'll just see what they do for a few minutes. I was told today that they were very full. I don't think they look particularly full at the moment. But male lions, well, you know, they do tend to be rather lazy scavenging things. Yeah, he's quite full. Yeah, I know, he's got a belly on him. That lion is very sleepy. Still, there is so much food around. Perhaps a wildebeest will come wandering past here. Perhaps a zebra. But he doesn't look like he's going anywhere too soon, does he? The other characteristic, apparently, of Morana is the fact that he is missing one of his bottom canines. And if he is Scarface's brother, as we suspect, well, then he is also between 10 and 12 years old, I think. Now let's just have a listen to the sounds of the Mara night, and I'll tell you what I can hear. I'm just going to stand up again. All right, let's be quiet, everybody. I can hear some frogs, some insects. I can hear one species of frog going at a waterhole off to the right of where we're sitting now. Perhaps where Morana and his blonde brother will go. Well, not brother, coalition mate. Don't know what they are at this stage. It's really a fascinating story to be unfolding here, and I'm sad we won't be able to do it for the next few months here, but we'll keep updating you as and when we hear anything back in South Africa. But otherwise, all is silent, much as it was yesterday. It's just a beautiful, beautiful night. Valeria in Massachusetts, you say, isn't it unusual that he should leave his brother? Or sort of forsake him, if you like, do a bit of a Brutus a la Julius Caesar on him. It is unusual, But is it? So, yes, it's unusual as far as the textbooks say that it's unusual. Is it unusual for this area, for the Mara Triangle, for the Mara, during a migration when the wildebeest are in situ and the wildebeest and the zebra are coming up as well? I don't know. I'm going to hesitate to say yes, it's unusual. Certainly in South Africa we would consider it extremely unusual. But apparently the migration, when it does come up here, creates an enormous amount of upheaval in the lions. And often the migration brings with it nomadic males and nomadic lions who are without territory, and sometimes that brings upheaval. I'm going to guess, though, that old Scarface is born of quite a lot more testosterone than his brother. Although his brother is pretty dark-maned, maybe his brother is just bigger. And I'm going to suggest that he was the dominant lion, and that when these guys came in and had a go at him, well, I guess I really hate myself for saying this, but a bit like Scar in The Lion King forsook his brother Mufasa, so perhaps Morana forsook his brother so that he could kind of get on with life and not be beaten up. That was not a conscious decision he made, but I think it's quite possible that in order to reduce conflict, he acted in a submissive fashion to the new males. And certainly the reason I think this is because the first night when we were watching them, we had the female, and she was calling, and these two blondies were calling, but Morana was absolutely stumm silent. So I think that's quite interesting. Right, back in South Africa, the wonderful Nkuhuma Pride lionesses are on the hunt. Let's go and take a look.
I'm now mobile in an easterly direction, straight through the Schlachting of Hyena Road. Yes. Huh? Oh, we live? Oh, did I pull myself out? I can't hear anybody, anyone. Ah, right. So, as you heard in my voice, this female is now moving straight through some thickets. How are we going to get in here? So, we stumbled across her. I had a suspicion that she was going to come this way. I need to try and find a way through here. And I think the rest of the lovely ladies are in the drainage line, so they've just been doing loops. So we had the right idea earlier this evening of where to try and find them. Oh, there they go. She goes, just watch your head here, Zander. There's a few thorns. Goodness gracious, please don't go down into the drainage. Sorry, Zander, watch your... Here they are. Got them, everybody. Got the lions. Woohoo! That wasn't too bad. Thank goodness. Now I can tell Jamie that we have got only four lions. So wait, that is very confusing, everybody. Very confusing. Let's park like this. Oh, whew. Whew, whew, whew. Now, the reason why I'm so confused is because of where I found that one female. She was sitting down in the middle of Hyena Road and waiting. So I don't know what's gone on. I thought it was maybe another female. Me tell Jamie that I've got them. Jamie, I've got them. We're in the middle of Hyena Road, but we're east of that, but also west of that next drainage. There's just former fuzzies here. They're temporarily static. Phew, everybody, I cannot tell you what a sigh of relief I'm feeling at the moment, because oh my goodness, I can't. They were going through some serious thick vegetation. Now, that was one of the mothers of the cubs, the one that's walking away and the one that we found. And she's obviously hungry. There she goes. And let's go back, though, because she's going to the thicket. Let's go back to the others. Look at this one. Just laying on her back. So comfortable. Now, I'm not sure if this is Amber Eyes or if this is that very young female. We'll have to have a look. I can't see any suckle marks or anything like that, so that's how I know it's either one of those two. But we shall see when she decides to get up. Now, I could also hear that male lion calling in the distance, and it sounds like he could be near Vuyotela camp. However, there are guests in the camp, everybody, so I can't go missioning too far away, but we'll probably go and investigate in a little bit. We've got Lou and Rebecca watching the dam cam just to make sure to see if he does come down. I'm going to stick with these three. Oh, they're starting to get up now. They are starting to get up. Who are you? You've got suckle marks. Oh, she goes. Now we're going to start moving again. I'm going to get Jamie to come around. Jamie, can you come around back to Hyena Road? Some of the Mafuzzies are up and mobile, back slightly more west. And we're going to get Jamie over here so she can come and give us a helping hand, everybody. You can hear that male lion calling in the distance again. Right, let's go back to these two. Now, I suspect the direction that they're going now is straight back towards those cubs. I thought we were going to get them going on the prowl. They look hungry. They're not particularly fat. So I don't know if it was a very big buffalo that they killed on Buffalo's Hook. Maybe just a medium-sized buffalo. It was enough to sort of be an appetizer. And now they're awaiting their main meal. There's a big yawn. Oh, life is so tough. Matilda. No, I don't know. That's not her name, everybody. Look at her rubbing her belly with her paw. Did you see that? That was awesome. Are you going to roll again for us? I'm so itchy on my belly. Oh my goodness, I've never seen a lion do that before. That is amazing. Please get some screenshots of this. That's hysterical. Wow. Oh, I believe she does do it quite frequently, but that's quite amazing. I've never seen that happening where a lion rubs its own belly. I think we're going to see some nice interaction. Hello. It's very important that they keep rubbing each other, keep strengthening the bond between the different lionesses. I'm eager to see who this is that's still resting here. Come on. Lucky last. Stand up for us. She's not ready to go. Now she's looking over. Oh, it looks like it could be maybe that young lioness. It doesn't look like she's got particularly amber colored eyes. And her nose looks quite pink still. So I think it's the young female. Now, where is Amber Eyes? I thought I saw her when we first found the lions. Very interesting. So hopefully Jamie's going to pick up on the others. I'm going to update her again. Jamie, I'm sticking with that young Mafuzzy Gonyam. The others have sort of gone a little bit further northwest of me now. Maybe you'll pick up on them when you come down the Ntlela. Okay, she's up and moving. We're also going to be up and moving, everybody. So I need to reverse out of this thicket, and I don't think I can go the same way as the lions. Phew, what? Oh, there they are. What are you looking at? Let me see if I can turn around this. Am I going to hit a tree on your side? Oh my good. Okay. I don't have any side mirrors, everybody. Oh, here they are again. Hang on, everybody. We need to switch to infrared, everybody. These females have heard something. And they are very excited. I'm going to switch to infrared now, so... Everybody ready? Lights off. Are you ready? Come on, Eggsy. There we go. We are on. If you listen very carefully, you can hear the lions roaring. That's one of the male lions calling. I think that's maybe why they're racing off. It's actually not because something to eat. I think they're going to try and find him. So I'm going to need to put a light back on. The lions have all gone again. Oh no, I've seen one, everybody. We're going to stay in infrared though. I'm going to just pick up my spotlight now just so I can see where I can go. But I think that's possibly why they raced off in that direction. Now, I don't know. Now we need to get out again. What's going on? What is going on? Lions are running, but I'm not sure why. Just one. That was bizarre. Oh my god, Jamie needs to get here very quickly to help me. This is too exciting. I need to switch off and listen. Jamie, can you fug a jumbo, please? I don't know where these Ngonyam have gone now. My daughter's colouring, my fun, my fuzzy's belegering, shtim. I'm trying to get Jamie here quickly, and I got a moth down my shirt. Okay, one female disappeared into the thicket. Can't follow her. Let's go further down the road where the others were going. Now, I've turned the volume down accidentally. Lou, can you still hear me? Because I don't know if I can hear you. I'm just talking to Lou, who's in final control. I can hear you now. I turned the volume down a little bit. Sorry. Just checking that the ladies are still with me. Now we're trying to figure out where these lions have gone again. They have given us the slipperoo. And I first initially thought that they were hunting. Now I'm not so certain because that male was calling and they seemed to dart off in his direction. I don't know if you were able to hear that at home. Lions, where are you, please? And I'm going to try and not also pull my earpiece out. So it's quite interesting to try and able to distinguish between a male and a female's roar. Now I know Katha in Germany wants to know, how on earth did I know that that was a male? That roar just sounded very deep and very gruff compared to what a female's roar would sound like. And the male's roars tend to go on for a little bit longer as well, and that went on forever. Not that it's a bad thing, quite pleasant actually. And I just need to work out what's happened to these lionesses. I have no idea where on earth they've gone. I'm going to just quickly check to the end of Hyena Road, and if I don't get lucky here, well, then I'm going to have to turn around and we're going to have to try again. Jamie's en route, and yes, I don't know. I don't know what to do, because that male sounded like he was a little bit further east of us, like he could have been perhaps approaching Biffles Hook Dam. I'm not sure. But one female went sprinting off. Right, let's go to Jamie, everybody. I'm going to try and find these lions again and let's just see how she's doing. Maybe she's found one.
We're on Hyena Road as well, and it's definitely an exciting time. I don't know exactly where these lions have gone. I'm not 100% sure where Taylor is either, to be honest. She must be somewhere in this thicket. And what we're doing is we're preparing to immediately switch to infrared as soon as I see them, and we drop our lights if they are hunting. Just trying to work out where they've gone and where exactly Taylor is. It might be worth just stopping for 1 second and listening. Let's just listen one moment. And check for chameleons at the same time. Nope. Wait, I hear them. Taking my earpiece out. I just heard one very soft, contact call. I'm switching Taylor onto open comms so that I can hear her. Come on, lions, where have you gone? Taylor, just stand by there. I think I heard a contact call to the west of me.
Sorry, Jane, go again.
Is that your visual I've got on Hyena Road?
Yeah, FM.
Just stand by there. I think I heard a contact call. So Taylor is just about 50 meters ahead of me. And we're just trying to hear if we can figure out where they've gone. Okay, I'll pop my earpiece back in now that I've got Taylor listening as well. They've gone into their favorite block. The block between Hyena Road and Gari Cutline. We're going to see if we can find these females. I'm just going to go up ahead to Taylor, see exactly which way they were going, and we'll catch up with you once you've been spent a bit of time with James and his lion.
So, rather unlike in the Sabi Sand, where the Ninkapumas are now walking through woodland, here, with the thermal camera, it's pretty easy to follow lions. When they're moving, if they're moving. This particular lion is not moving. He's just put up his head, though, and he's sitting underneath a gorgeous tree there, sort of sticking out on its own in the clearings. Now, why he's got his head up is because he's centered on the wind, something that Graham has found with the thermal camera. So we'll just have a quick look at the thermal view. That's me there. Hello, everybody. And there's the thermal view. Those are zebras. And they're not walking straight towards us. They're kind of walking parallel with us and possibly around. And that's why he lifted his... That's why he lifted his head, because their scent is blowing straight towards him. I just stopped speaking there briefly because it looked like there was a hot spot in the middle of that shot. But I don't think that's anything. So there go the zebras. The lions, like I say, I think look pretty full. So I'm not sure they're actually going to do anything. We knew the game was up yesterday evening, you know, when those lions started calling. The females started calling, advertising their territory, and we knew that they were no longer going to be on the hunt. This fellow's decided that he's got very dirty nails that he'd like to clean. What with it being Friday night and all? Jeez, this is amazing. Hello, Spencer. You're a new viewer and you ask a very good question. You say, is it common for lions to be nocturnal hunters? Spencer, it is not only common, it is typical in many areas that they are nocturnal hunters. Now, I would have said before I came here that they're almost exclusively nocturnal hunters. They will take the opportunity during the day if they can to hunt, but often they don't. Now, in the Mara here, because there's so much around, at least of the four or five kills we've heard of while we've been here, one of which we've witnessed, they've been during the day. Then we've witnessed one at night, but we've watched many failed attempts yesterday evening. So the lions here do kill during the day, and lions will take the opportunity to kill whenever they can. So it's not necessarily only during the night time that they kill. It's a good question, Spencer. Leopard as well, I think, do a lot more of their killing during the day than we think they do. He is deeply, deeply fatigued by life here in the Mara Triangle. But he's not panting, which means that he's not really that full. I think the Blondie is probably fuller than Morana, if that is him. Now, that Blondie there that we're looking at is missing a bottom right canine. And I think I confused the information I got today by saying Morana was missing his bottom right canine. I think it's this Blondie. He's also got a very dirty face. Yes, you do. That's correct. A dirty face. Mm-hmm. And big claws. Yes. And it almost looks to me like he's got a torn left ear. Ah, wonderful question from Belly the Backpacker. Belly the Backpacker, you want to know how much more food these lions eat compared to the lions of the Sabi Sand. At this time of the year, I'm going to say I reckon they eat probably 20% more. Although, you know, given the drought that there's been, Kahuma Pride has been eating a lot of food lately. They've been killing many of the buffalo, and they kill bigger prey there, seemingly, than they do here. But there's so much now between July and October for these chaps to eat that I'd say they probably eat 20% more at this time of the year. But when those zebra and wildebeest and Thompson's gazelle and eland head out of the Mara, things become a little bit more lean. They don't become impossible, but they become leaner, and I think you'll find they probably eat, I don't know, maybe 10% less than the Nkuhuma Pride does in the height of a drought. It really does vary on the time of year, though, so how to answer whether or not they eat more in total than the Nkuhumas, I don't know. I don't know how I would answer that question. I'm going to say maybe slightly more, but given the... Well, I mean, given the difference in prey or the number of prey species when the migration moves off to the south, I'm going to say it's probably very similar. Well, this is more activity than we had last night for those lions after, well, bar the three little hunts. And those wildebeest are now well past. They're not walking towards him anymore. So he's no longer scenting them on the wind. They've moved out of the wind trail. But maybe he'll sit up and give us a call. Maybe he'll flop down and go back to sleep. He looked almost like he might have been enthused enough to get up there. No? Don't you want to go and do something, hunt something? There's lots around. Won't be here forever. See the wind starting to pick up a little bit coming out of the north. Fiona, that's a very interesting question. You want to know if I think lions have a preference, if they like to vary their diets, if they get bored of the food that they eat and think to themselves, gee whiz, if I have to eat another wildebeest, I'm going to be sick. Give me a zebra or some warthog. Fiona, I don't know. I mean, I'm assuming the meat must taste different. Do they have taste buds as sophisticated as ours? Absolutely not. I think we've got the most taste buds per square area, or per area on our tongues, than any other animal in the world. So I wouldn't say that the taste necessarily bugs them too much. So I'm going to say no, I don't think they necessarily get sick of things. What they will start to do perhaps, though, oh gosh, there we go, fast asleep. What they will start to do, if in perhaps they're in a drought time, they'll start to notice the lack of fat on the animals they're eating, surrounding those crucial organs, the liver and the kidneys, and possibly even the lungs. They'll notice the fat disappearing from that in a drought, and they will notice the, well, I mean, physiologically, they will notice the lack of fat in the diet. Does that then translate to them trying to catch something a bit fatter and fattier? I don't know. Certainly it would with elephants, not, for example, I know they're not going to eat meat, but they are intelligent enough, certainly, to go off and try and eat different kinds of foods depending on what their physiologies happen to be lacking. But I don't know about these lions. Very nice question. I like those ones. Not able to answer them properly, which means that it makes us all have a good think. Brilliant. Yeah, I don't know that these chaps are going to do anything tonight. We may do a little traverse around just now to see if we can't find the lioness who has been with that dark-maned male. Hello, Cecilia. You want to know what other predators are around here, other than the lions and the hyenas? Well, there are cheetah here. I think that they're making themselves scarce at this time of the year because there are so many other predators. There are lots of lions here. There are nomadic lions who are not normally here. They're kind of here for the festival of the wildebeest at the moment. There are many, many hyenas, as you saw. Likewise, there are probably a couple of nomads knocking about here. And that means that the cheetah will be scarce. You can almost predict a cheetah's distribution by the presence of male lions and even their calls. When a male lion calls, it's highly unlikely you'll find a cheetah nearby, because they are the main killers of cheetah, more often. And so, I think you'll find not many cheetah here at the moment. Probably in 4 months' time, or maybe even 2 or 3 months' time, there'll be more cheetah activity. There is one cheetah around here since we've been here. We think she's quite a famous cheetah called Matilda. What a name for a cheetah that is. Anyway, we think she's around this area, but we haven't been lucky enough to see her yet. Then, of course, the aardvark, which is a kind of hyena. It's quite possible to get a striped hyena here sometimes. Maybe a wild dog. Definitely a serval, which we saw. We saw a few servals, and possibly African wildcats as well. The Nkuhuma pride are behaving completely unlike these two lazy males. They're up and at it and on the hunt. Let's go and take a look.
And we had them, and now the lions are gone again, everybody. So we're going to have to try and reposition and get to them. So you're just going to have to take my word, I'm afraid, and I'm coming undone. My goodness, the wheels are coming off the wagon. Okay, I'm back together again. Am I connected? Yes. Phew. It's been a really adventurous evening already. And these girls are on the move. They just keep hiding away. I don't know what they're doing now. Oh, we're going to have to watch this branch.
Spider.
Eggs is very worried about the spider. Right, everyone. Sorry, we're navigating through off-road here, and it's more difficult to off-road at night. During the day, it's much easier, but let's stop here and let's have a look, and hopefully Jamie can get up ahead and then we can have a glimpse. Here we go, we've got all four of them again.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. There we go, infrared. How cool is that? They're not hunting now though. They seem to be going straight back towards where those cubs were going, or where they left the cubs, sorry. And I'm still confused as to what's going on and what they're doing and where that male is. Because we heard him calling. He was roaring up an absolute storm. And now he's gone very quiet again. So I wonder if he isn't possibly already making his way back to the cubs. Jamie did say that she heard some contact calling earlier, so that's possibly it. Okay, back we go a little bit. And over a few little trees, not big ones, that the elephants have pushed over. Go on, Wendy, you can do it. Whee! Just sort of think of it like show jumping, but Wendy doesn't jump. Hee, now what? Now where do we go? Lionesses, I wish you would walk on the road. Right, let's go to Jamie. We're going to leapfrog. She's got the lions again.
Four Nkuhuma lionesses on a mission through the block. What an incredible sight this is. On the hunt, sniffing around, they haven't spotted anything. Oh, somebody's doing some scratching. Scratching her claws down the silver cluster leaf tree, helping to keep those claw sheaths nice and healthy. And also, I think it actually feels quite nice for them. I think they enjoy doing it. Look, the second lioness is going to enjoy and join in. Mm-hmm. Here we go. Look at that. Awesome. She's biting the tree as well a little bit. Oh, that's so cool. See them drawing lines. Now, cheetah and leopard often do this to mark their territories. And there's I suppose it makes sense that lionesses might as well. It also stretches out their tendons of the claw sheaths and allows them to keep those claws in tip-top shape. Because, of course, as they head into the night, they are most definitely going to need them. You ready for this, Dave?
Good.
Let's do it. Okay, so it's not the easiest block in the world to navigate, but it's okay. It's not the hardest either. And it's not my first time. Watch out there, Dovey. Uh-oh. Problem. Crisis. Tree. Lioness is on the move. You ready, Dobby? Can we get under here?
Yep.
Go for it. Whoop, whoop. Stop going north. Please. Please stop going north. Oh, no. You're not going to stop going north. We're probably about 50 meters away from the Buffalo's Hook boundary. Here's our lovely lionesses. Awesome. What an amazing view. We've been fortunate enough to watch the technique of the lions in Kenya. Our lions have a slightly different habitat to compete with. You can see this dense vegetation that we're going to have to try and slide through now. Okay, there she goes. Let's carry on. I don't know how well we're going to manage this, but we're going to try. Luckily, we've got Taylor off to my right, ready to leapfrog ahead. Can I get through those trees? That is the question. Will I try? Yes. This is the fun part of this whole. Oh. Experience. Luckily, Steph's in Hoedspruit. Sorry, Rusty. You ready? I'm not ready. I don't know where I'm going. There I'm going. You okay, Dave? We really don't want to damage our cameramen. They're quite irreplaceable, you know. You good?
Yep.
Sorry, Dave. Oh, my word. Can I do this? We're about to find out. Yes. Oh. I'm going to lose them. I'm stuck. I can try and get through here. Dave, are you ready?
Yeah.
You ready to try? Yeah. Let's do it. Turning off my spotlight for now. I need both hands to stall casually. You ready? I bet James doesn't miss this. That's going to hurt. You ready? We're going to get visual of these lions in 2 seconds. There they are. There they go. Walking as one unit off into the distance. Yeah, we can do it. Are we going to get a flat tire? Probably. Is it worth it? Absolutely. To be privileged enough to watch these incredible cats go about their nightly business is just unbelievable. The thrill, I can't begin to tell you. The excitement coursing through everybody's veins, including theirs. They're on the search, they're on the hunt. For now, just wondering. Watch out, Dave. Yep, comes the strangled cry from the back. Why is my door open? That's okay. Deja vu, I've been here before. I think they're on their way back towards the cubs. There they go. Back to their favorite place around Gari Cutline, where over the last few weeks they have had endless success with catching buffalo and raising a healthy, happy group of cubs. Okay, now if I remember correctly, this road, it's not a road, it's a two-track, goes off to the left and then hopefully we'll come back to the right. That's my plan. If it doesn't, well, I'll think of a new one as we go along. No, it doesn't. Disaster! Deborah in South, oh my word. Holy mackerel. No, I can't do this. It would be silly. I'll wreck the car. Sorry, Dave. Now, Deborah in South Carolina, you want to know if the missing lioness that is not with this group is with the cubs. And the answer is maybe. I'm not 100% sure. I'm not 100% sure where I'm going to go either. I think they got on their way straight back towards the cubs. So my sense of urgency is slightly dimmed. I'm going to try and do this a bit more carefully so I don't damage Dave. It's possible. It's also possible because I'm not sure were all five of them with Taylor this afternoon when you were with them. Because if so, then yes, there's a good chance she's with the cubs. If not, then she's probably off mating somewhere. Well, there's a chance she's off mating somewhere. We've heard lots of lion vocalizations as we've been trundling along. There's that spider web. I know where we are. I think they're going back towards the cubs. This two track is definitely taking me in the wrong direction though. Poor Dave. You okay there? Good. You're a soldier. Okay, we have to do this. We have to get all the way to the drainage line along this two track, and then we're going to have to turn north again. We might have encountered the fifth lioness as we trundle along. You never know. Oh, there's a stump. Okay. I'm going to swing north and start heading to head the lionesses off. Let's go back to James and his lions.
Look, everybody, we've moved. And we've moved because the lions have not moved. We're just trying to get a slightly different perspective on things. And as you can see, well, there isn't much of a different perspective on things. Let's have one look at the FLIR camera, at least the thermal imaging camera, and we'll show you the lion first, and then we'll scan slowly from side to side and see if we can't see some prey coming this way. One of them did lift its head briefly. There's the other one, lying very sleeplessly. At least sleepfully. And otherwise, these clearings seem remarkably free of life, which is strange. There's the beginnings of the Ololo Escarpment. There's a big herd of probably wildebeest or zebra or buffalo up there. And clearly nothing these lions are too concerned about. And I think the reason everything is not hunting right now is that so much food came into this area today. We woke up this morning, looked down over the escarpment, down onto the ground, onto the valley floor here, and there were wildebeest massing by the tens of thousands. Anyway, I think one or two of them got whacked during the day, devoured or eaten, or even last night perhaps. And they are no longer feeling the need to eat. We haven't seen these lions hungry. They've been basically fat for the last 5 days, almost a week. There they are. And so deeply, perfectly content. And of course, they are making hay while the sun shines, which of course all animals should do, including ourselves. The reason they're doing that, well, there's lots of food here now. It won't be here forever. I'm very interested to see that the Nkuhumas are on the hunt. It would be so wonderful to get them on the hunt and actually killing again. We have had them once or twice on the hunt, of course, but it's not that easy to following them. Ellen, you're in Arkansas. You say, how far from the river are these lions? And it's a very good question, and you're justifying it by saying, surely it would make sense for them to hang around at the crossing points. I think some of those lions do. Certainly the one that we saw killing today, we saw a lion killing a young wildebeest as it came out of the river today. Yes, they seem to lurk about in the areas around where the crossings happen. I think it's a bit of a stretch to suggest that they have actually learned precisely where all the wildebeest cross, because then I do think, Ellen, that there would be lions around those crossings all the time, and those crossings would then not be crossings anymore, because much like with the crocodiles, I think the wildebeest would work it out, that they, well, no, except that's actually rubbish I'm talking now. I don't think the wildebeest would work it out. They seem to cross regardless with the crocs. But I think if there were lions on the ground, they'd probably learn to avoid the area eventually. Anyway, I do think it's a good question, though, and I wonder, I mean, certainly in South Africa, we know that, well, anywhere where there is water holes as opposed to rivers, we know that lions concentrate around those water holes, because they know that their prey have to come and drink. But I think there's just so much going on over here. There's so much to eat away from the rivers that there's no real point for the lions to go knocking about and lurking on the riverbeds all the time. So that's what I think is going on here. I'm just going to describe what I can smell. Much like the lion, I'm tilting my nose to the air. I can smell smoke in the air, interestingly. I wonder if there isn't a fire somewhere not too close to here, or not too far from here. I can't smell the zebra, though. I will tell you that one of the roads we drove yesterday, though, had a very distinctive smell of very fresh wildebeest dung. Taylor has managed to re-find the mobile lions of Juma. Let's go and take a look.
Oh my goodness, everybody, what a mission this has been. I'm going to take my spotlight off them. They are coming right up to where the cubs were now. We're sitting basically at the temporary den site, so it's going to be interesting to see what happens now, and to hopefully see their interaction, the welcoming that the little ones are going to give mom. Though I'm sure they were hoping, though, that they were going to come back bearing gifts. There we go, you can just see them popping into your screen now. Don't worry, everybody, that's an infrared light. We've just turned all the infrared lights. We are sitting in complete darkness. It's really weird having these lions walking around us, and I can't see anything, and I'm hearing strange noises in the night. It's quite daunting. So I can understand what Jamie was talking about the other evening when all those lions roared. And we've just got the two that have come through so far. I'm going to quickly look. Oh no, there's another one. See, that freaks me out, because I only saw two coming towards us. Oh, they're calling. I just heard Jamie let out a woohoo at the back, so she must be doing all right and finding her way out. We had some interesting time trying to get out too. Now, it's quite difficult to see, but you can see those little ones moving in the middle of your screen. Obviously very happy to see mom back again and the rest of the females. I'm going to try and get us a better picture in a moment. I'll try and reposition. Let's just see what these ladies get up to. If these females do start moving with the cubs, though, I'm unfortunately going to leave them and let them be, just because it's almost impossible to navigate through this thick bush without normal lights on. Where are you going? And it looks like they are on the move. Let's just see if they're going to come back out or if they're going to go down into the drainage line. I can't see them anymore. Can still hear that male lion calling in the distance. Where have they gone? Okay, let's try and reposition. I'm just going to put my light behind my vehicle. I'm not shining on the cubs, so I need to try and navigate that kind of here. Let's try and do this. Turn a little bit. I think I need to do a 67 million point turn. I think that these females have actually disappeared down into the drainage. Yeah. Sorry, everybody, I'm just trying to navigate. Try this again. Now, can we see anything down here? This is another little gap. What's that? That is a leaf. I cannot see these lions anymore, and I cannot hear them. Everybody, I'm afraid that these lions have disappeared down into the drainage. I can hear them. They're in the drainage line. They're moving. So what we're going to do now is, unfortunately, we're going to have to leave these females with their cubs. Like I said, I just don't think it's fair on the little ones. I think they're going to get quite scared with the vehicles. And we'll let them have their time. The females gave us a fantastic show. Maybe we'll try and follow up on that male. I'll speak to Jamie now on the radio and see what she thinks. But I'm sure she'll agree with me with leaving these moms and their cubs. But they do look hungry, but maybe they're only going to hunt much later. Let me quickly get hold of Jamie. Jamie Taylor. Oh, I'm pressing all the buttons on the radio and none of the right ones. Copy, Jamie. The Mafuzzies and the Muntuans all disappeared into the drainage. They went west. I'm not going to follow them until they possibly lay down. I might go do a loop and see if I can find that my daughter that's colouring. Just chatting to Jamie, everybody. So Jamie's going to go and check Gowrie Cutline just to see. Perhaps they do come out there. Then maybe we'll be able to have another view. Otherwise, let's do a little loop. Let's head towards Biffles Hook Dam very quickly and see if we can find this male that's calling in the distance. Right. Ooh, while I try and navigate out here, let's head to Jamie for a little update.
We made it! Whoopee! We made it out of the drainage line. By the way, that was Dave's whoopee, not mine. I would just like to clarify. Hey, Taylor. Okay, we're going to go and check Gowrie Cutline. Phew. It's quite a workout trying to get through that block. And we tried to go around in case the lionesses weren't going back towards the cubs, which worked. I just had to then try and find my way out of it. But it's okay. We're in one piece. We're quite safe. Oh, my arms are slightly tired, but other than that, we're all in good shape. The reason that Dave said whoopee was we nearly got stuck, but then we didn't. To cut a long story short, there was a brief moment of wheel spinning as we trapped ourselves on a leadwood log. But we're out. And we're going to try and go around Gowrie Cutline. Phew. I think we have an answer though about our lioness and the missing one. I don't think she was with the cubs. And Benny the backpacker, on the subject of, I'm sure Rusty didn't used to creak like that. On the subject of, it's a bushbuck. On the subject of our Birmingham boys, because of course there is one calling somewhere, he wanted to get an update on the injured Birmingham male and whether or not his face was healing up. I assume you're talking about the one, Shame. He had the big hole in his face, a massive abscess that burst, or something similar. Hold on, Dave. Here we go. Up the hill we go. Whee! And the answer is he's looking 10 times better. Are you still on there, Dave? His face is healed up. I mean, I don't know how, but when we last saw him, it was a glistening, healthy pink. It was still a hole, but it was a glistening, healthy pink. And he was looking 10 times better than when we last saw him. So really very impressive, the ability of these animals to heal. It never fails to astound me just how resilient they truly are. So his face was looking much better. He was still sore. He was still, that side, he was still pawing at it and rubbing it and unhappy. He was twitching and I think it was still, it's still a little bit infected. It's making him feel unwell, a little bit grumpy. But he'll be fine. And he'll have a nice big scar to show for it, as male lions do. And he'll be loads better, probably by the next time we see him, when we next see him. It might even be difficult to see exactly. No, you'll see it. You will see it, because it's quite a big dent. But he was a lucky one. I've read and recently spoken to quite a few people who've told a couple of horror stories about animals that have ended up with maggot infestations in their cheeks and around their sinuses. Okie dokie. I'm going to make my way to the big leadwood tree, which is opposite where the Nkuhumas like to hide out, and see whether or not they decide to pop up here. And keep watching the Juma Dam camera, please. Keep an eye on them, on that. There's a chance they might come and try and have a drink there. If I don't have a flat tire when I wake up tomorrow morning, I will be suitably impressed. Okay. Let's just stop here for 1 second. Okay, we're going to stop and just listen for a while, see whether or not the Nkuhumas do come out. And while we wait, let's head back to James, whose lion has been a lot less mobile than ours has.
The lion has moved his tail very slightly to the right-hand side. There, oh, look at that, a back leg is moving. Good. Excellent. Not else, or nothing else has happened. I'm very, very pleased that you've had the Ninkapumas there on the hunt, but of course it is quite thick in there. And so I hope that Jamie and Taylor managed to relocate the male, because of course he will then look fairly. Well, it'll be a good opportunity for you to compare him with these two here. But really, they are beyond flat cat at this stage. Anyway, we're going to sit with them for a bit longer and let's see what they do. Let's have a quick recap. We are coming to you from the Mara Triangle, completely live. My name is James Henry Jandre, is on camera. And also in the vehicle, I've forgotten to introduce you during the course of the day. Mrs. Wallington is sitting in the back. Mr. Wallington operating the thermal imaging camera behind. And in the front seat here, we have Daniel, an Askari from the Olulolo Gate. And he is just keeping a watch on us, keeping us safe. And it's a great privilege to have him with us. We are in the Mara Triangle doing two things. We're trying to tell the story of the lions here and also the story of the migration. And we've had an astounding day today. We saw three crossings, one with just wildebeest, thousands of them streaming across the plains, at least across the river. And then the last one, the very last one to come out of the water, being smacked by a lioness. She took him down, pinned him against a termite mound and snuffed the life out of him eventually. The first thing she did though, which was a little difficult to watch, was that she suffocated him. He obviously lost consciousness because he couldn't breathe anymore, and then she let go because she was tired, and then he started to breathe again, so he got up and she had to grab him again, and that was a little disconcerting to see. Anyway, that's how it is out here. And that kind of savagery, awe-inspiring as it is part of what it is to live here in the wilderness. Then two other lionesses, we don't know who they were, joined her. Nobody seemed to know exactly which pride of lions they were, but it was a new set of characters for us here in the Maasai Mara Triangle. Then, after that, we headed off towards another crossing point, and a mixed herd of wildebeest and zebra dived into the water, where just before they'd been chased off by some crocodiles. The crocodiles went crazy. Huge 15-foot reptilian dinosaurs of the deep went leaping around, and they caught, I think, 3 or 4 of the wildebeest there. I don't think they managed to get a zebra, did they, Jean-Henri? I think they just managed to get a couple, 4 or 5 wildebeest. Then they kind of floated off down the road, down the river, and I thought to myself I'd made a mistake, because we were asked the other day, where is it best to be, front, middle, or back of the herd? And I thought, well, I'd want to be in the middle. Turns out that's not the case. Lions aren't moving, are they?
No.
No. I thought I heard something. I thought I heard a pussycat. It turns out the back of the herd is the best place to be, and that is because the lions... Oh no, sorry, it's Daniel moving around here that I keep hearing. That's because the crocodiles, once they've got their prey, they float off down the river and then they ignore everyone else coming across. So that was a good place to be. Then we went to check on another crossing to see if anything was going on there. We had a rather amusing scene of one lonely wildebeest facing off. He was sort of lying down on the banks of the river, looking at about 15 crocodiles who were staring up at him. And I thought it was quite an amusing scene. And then we thought we'd take one more look at the main river crossing where, for me, one of the highlights of the day, you know, probably not the highlight, but one of, Thompson's gazelles coming into the water and swimming across. Now, Thompson's gazelle is a tiny thing. They're probably only, what did they, we decide? We decided they're between 25 and 30 kilograms. That's between sort of just over 50 pounds and 50 and 65 pounds only. So they're tiny. They leapt into the water. They prevaricated for a while, as all the animals do, leapt into the water, and the crocodiles immediately gave chase. They shot into the water like reptilian speedboats, swishing their tails from side to side. And when they caught up with 2 or 3 of the Thompson's gazelles, they just grabbed them in one bite, pulled them under the water, and that was the last we see of them. There wasn't any of the kicking or fighting that the wildebeest managed to do. When those crocs came up to the Thompsons, they grabbed them, didn't matter from which side, front on, side on, back on, didn't matter, they dragged them under the water and they were gone. And the highlight of that little sighting was a tiny Thompson's gazelle. Couldn't have been bigger than that. It managed to swim its way across unscathed, climb nimbly up the bank, seemed to find the rest of the herd, and off it went safely. How many times it's going to have to cross that river, and how many times it's going to do that, play that roulette without losing its life, well, no one knows. But it's an amazing thing to see. Then we went off to try and find the Kitrotembo pride. They very ill-manneredly killed a wildebeest while we were watching the crossing. They are fat and very asleep, as are these two male lions now. Shall we have another look at them, Jandro, rather than my mug? There we have it. Hello, Angie. You wondering if there's any animal that might terrorize a crocodile? Angie, no, not really, you know. I think the thing that terrorizes a crocodile most is another crocodile. I have seen footage of leopards giving crocodiles a go. And we all know that the jaguars eat the caimans sometimes in the Amazon. But very little, I mean, very seldom. Sometimes lions will give crocodiles a bit of a hard time, but I didn't think anything terrifies them. Once they're in the water there, very little will have a go at them. I think maybe the main terrorizer of crocodiles, come to think of it, is the other water dweller, the other large water dweller, and that is the hippopotamus. I think crocs are nervous of hippos, they avoid them, they don't like to go towards them too much, and certainly we've seen times where hippopotamus have rescued animals being devoured by crocodiles, they've rescued them away from the crocs, and we had an amazing, I mean today, while the crocs were sort of creating their mayhem, snapping hither and yon with their great big jaws, pulling wildebeest under the water and pulling zebra under the water, interestingly, one of the big hippo bulls from the pod that lives quite around about the main crossing point came up and sort of got in the way of the migration moving across the water, and we don't really know why that was. The wildebeest certainly tried to avoid him, but I don't know if the crocs then tried to avoid him, if he was trying to stand on one of the crocodiles, I don't know. but certainly crocodiles avoid hippopotami when they can. It's difficult to believe these lions are actually alive. James Richard, very appropriate question. You say, since we've already achieved everything we set out to here in the Mara, is there anything we want to see before we leave? Anything on the wish list? Yes, there is. That's why we're sitting here with two male lions. We're rather hoping to see a male lion get off his lazy cat bottom and go hunting. We'd really like to see a male lion do something other than lie about the place. There's just so much food around, though, that I don't think these things are going to move for love nor money tonight, unless a zebra happens to stand on them, or a warthog happens by on his way home from the pub, or perhaps a wildebeest herd decides that they're not going to follow the normal path and heads up onto these grasslands. Otherwise, I think these male lions are going to sleep soundly. It's a warm evening. There's a bit of wind blowing now. But otherwise, everything is completely calm and very pleasant out here, I must say. It was about 32 degrees Celsius, I suppose. That's about 85 degrees Fahrenheit. No, it's not. Is it? Yes, it is about 85 degrees Fahrenheit today. So very pleasant. Fran, sorry, I missed your question. We see, can we have it again? Interesting that, Fran, you say, will these males be more tolerant of the nomads coming into the area than perhaps the Birminghams would, because there's so much more food around? Fran, you know, I think they probably would. I mean, there are nomads around. We've seen them. We've seen these guys in the same vicinity as the nomads. So, well, what we think are nomads. So, yeah. I think there probably would be, and I think it's probably precisely because there's so much food around, there's just not much threat. I think were those nomads to go towards their pride, if they happen to be around the prides, or if they happen to roar, the nomads, or start marking territory, I think the tolerance would be infinitely less than it is now. But yeah, I would say there probably is a certain amount of increased tolerance given the amount of food.
Zebras are running this way.
The zebras seem to be running this way, everybody. Chief thermal camera operator G. Wallington says the zebras are massing this way. There they are. Apparently they're alarm calling. Oh, they're heading this way. Oh, what's happened there? Oh dear. We seem to have had some sort of power cut. Never mind. The flare's back up. Louise is saying, is there a fourth blob there? I'm looking at it now, Louise. There does seem to be some running, though.
They're running hither and thither.
They're running hither and thither. There's the sort of semi-missing ear, I think. They are running hither and thither. Let's go back to the thermal camera gendry, if you don't mind. But now they do seem to be running straight towards us. There they are. They're coming straight here, aren't they? This is astounding. Are the lions up? We better have a quick look at the lions. Up, yes, but facing the opposite direction. Wake up, you idiot. The zebra's coming. Yes, the wind has changed direction. Look, it's blowing his very unkempt mane towards the zebras. They're now moving off. I'll just keep you posted. They're moving off to the right of us. What number are they at, Graham? They're at about 7:30 to us now. So moving past the back of the car. He's sort of looking in their direction. They're going to lose his scent now.
But something's up with him. That ear is mangled. Looks like he's been playing in the front row of a rugby scrum for many years. I thought I might have been able to hear a lion way in the distance. Rachel, you say thank you so much for allowing people who cannot visit Africa the chance to experience it. Rachel, that's why we do what we do. And it's an absolute joy to bring it to you. It's not a trial. It hardly feels like work most of the time. And so really, it's not for us to, or for you to thank us. It's for us to thank you for watching and especially for taking the time to send us your comments. So thank you very much for that, Rachel. Without you, we wouldn't have a show, would we? And so thank you for watching. And I'm so glad that you're enjoying being in Africa with us. The zebras are now going away again. They're now at 9 o'clock. So in relation to the lion, the lion's basically at 11 o'clock from us. And the zebras are at 9 o'clock. So he's actually looking at them. And just before you think I'm being a complete idiot by not knowing what Graham's to, or, you know, not being able to see where the zebras are, all I've got is that little screen that you can see when Jandre pans down to it. And it's almost impossible to keep your bearings on what's going on. There we are. There we are, panning off to where they are. They're walking past these chaps, but they're probably how far? It's quite difficult to judge distance. What do you
think? They crossed the road, so we were not far away from the road.
Okay. They've crossed to the other side of the road.
Yeah, they're just on the other side.
Okay. Graham says they've crossed to the other side of the road. We're not far from the road now. Let's go back to the lion, see if he's decided to get up and follow. Goodness, wouldn't it be an amazing way to end this evening with a giant male lion on the hunt? Gosh, he looks absolutely set to by life, doesn't he? Yes, you do. There, you can see the broken tooth. There, he can see them now. Or he can certainly smell them. I don't think they have any idea he's here. But there's no reason for them to come past here. So they're moving kind of on a trajectory that I think that's going to take them away from him. But we'll see. We'll sit here for a bit longer and see what he does. See if he actually gets up. Or if he just falls asleep again. Oh, what an interesting question. Fiona, you're in the United Kingdom. You say, I mentioned earlier that a little while back they stitched or darted and stitched Scarface up. And you want to know, do they intervene a bit more here in the Mara? I think you'll find the two reasons for that. Apparently they stitched up his eye, which had become quite badly injured. But as far as I understand, that's not the first time that he's had the attentions of the vet. So let me split this into two. The second time, I'm not sure how he injured his eye, but I think you'll find that his fame and his value as an attraction of tourists to this area perhaps would have made them err on the side of having him fixed up rather than just letting him go quietly into the night. You know how it is. Rich people are able to get good medical care, as are all celebrities. Scarface is no different. But the second time that it happened to him, as far as I'm aware, one of the great conflicts of this area, and it's an ancient one, is between the nomadic or pastoralist cattle herd is the Maasai people. And of course, there are no fences between their lands and the reserve. And Scarface strayed off into pastoral lands, and he fell foul of a Maasai warrior who was looking after his cattle. And he got a spear to the guts, as far as I understand it. And the vet was called him, fixed him up, and he was, you know, he survived okay. So I think that, you know, obviously would have been something they would have done in the Sabi Sand as well. Absolutely, they would have helped a lion that had been hurt by human effect. Yeah, look, I said he had a belly on him. He doesn't look hungry. He certainly is on the move now. Let's just see if he goes anywhere. He's got a limp too. Well, let me just wait. Here we go. Wonderful. My reputation as the bush laxative precedes me, and I have now succeeded in making a Mara lion times two go to the loo on live television. Well done, James. It's so nice to have such an incredible talent. It really is. There you are. Gosh, what a picture. Thank you, Jandro. It is amazing how that happens. I have to barely look at an animal before it will do precisely what this one just has. See if he actually moves now. Or goes fast asleep. Or starts perhaps to roar. He's looking after those zebra, you know. His mate, however, what's he doing, Jandro? The other one's head is up too. There we go. Back down to sleep. Let's keep watching and see what happens. You will see some light probably filling the screen. That is a vehicle coming along the main road now. Probably some rangers out on patrol. Doing roughly Mach 3. No, that's not fair. They're not actually going too fast at all. And I'm just thinking, I don't think they would have seen us, you know. We've got these infrared lights on. Their beams didn't hit us at all. So I don't think they would have seen us at all. He's gone back to sleep. Anyway, that's the one we think is called, what is it again? I've forgotten it now. Morana, that's it. That's who we think it is. Brother to Scarface, the great lion of the Mara Triangle. They're one of the blonde usurpers. Where the other blonde usurper is, we don't know. Scarface is knocking about this area somewhere. Maybe the blonde usurper had best watch his back. I suppose as should Morana, given that he has seemingly betrayed his brother, his illustrious brother. Alrighty, these catties are flat. Let's head back to Taylor, find out if she's managed to find the Ninkapuma Pride or perhaps one of the Birminghams. In the meantime, we'll sit with these great males and see if they bother to get up.
We don't even have any flatty catties, I'm afraid. We have lost the Nkuhumas. They disappeared off into a drainage line with their cubs. And we just thought it wasn't fair to follow such young cubs at night. Even though we do have infrared, but it's almost impossible for Jamie and I to maneuver off-road without using some form of artificial lighting. And those cubs are a little bit too young. Sorry. That was weird. I had a moth go in my ear and then down my shirt. And we've decided to leave them alone. Jamie is standing by on the outside of the drainage to see if they do perhaps come out again. And unfortunately, that Birmingham mail that we heard roaring seems to have crossed north. We haven't seen him, however, when he does give off a roar, it sounds like it's further north of our boundary, which is a bit sad. So none of the females are responding to him, so perhaps he's doing a territorial patrol, or is looking for some of his brothers who are somewhere in the area. Remember, we did have some of the other rangers telling us that they heard some lions calling what sounded like to be on Torchwood. So maybe he was responding to those calls. Now, it's a bit chilly, and I was going to tell you that it is so nice because the moths and beetles aren't as bad. And then as I was about to say that, I had the one flying to my ear and then down my shirt. So they're coming out slowly, but it's still a bit chilly. So we haven't even seen any scorpions tonight. I haven't seen any beetles. I haven't seen any shongololos. And only a couple of bush babies, and none of them would sit still. I'd spot them and then they would leap away into the very dense vegetation, which is not ideal. So I wonder what else we're going to find on this fine evening. It's perfect hunting weather for the Ngahumas. So hopefully they do decide to drop those little ones off and continue hunting. I think I saw that Jamie went a little bit further south. So I might quickly drive Gari Cutline just to have a quick look and see maybe if they haven't popped up behind her. However, I think after their long walk that they went on this evening, that took Jamie and I through some very thick vegetation, I think they need a little nap. And I suspect that they're going to have a little rest and possibly in the wee hours of the morning maybe go out again and look for something to eat. Right, nothing here. Like I said, it's a great evening to hunt. You know, something I haven't been seeing much of lately in the last few drives is buffalo. I don't think I've seen any on our safari marathons. Maybe the lions have scared them all away or eaten them all. Where are you animals? I just had a beetle commit suicide. It flew into my spotlight, everybody, and I heard a great thud. At least it didn't go down my shirt this time. And those of you at home are probably laughing at us and having a good giggle. It's not funny. It's very much frustrating. Come on, Birmingham boy, come across. Nope. Just checking to see if there's any fresh lion footprints or leopard footprints or any footprints. That's very far away. Sometimes we see these little eyes in the distance. We're not 100% certain what they are, but I'm just going to go with common dacre. It's normally a good one. They're quite tricky. They look like a serval's eyes or even a genet's eyes. They're just that far enough off the ground to look suspicious. Right here, everybody. Oh, hang on. Can we go into infrared? Lovely ladies in final control. Are we ready to go? And we are infrared actually already. Look at this. We've got a little common dacre. Now, it looks like a youngster. Firstly, because it's not running away from us. And I've seen a trend in young common dacre, how they tend to hang around. And also, it's much smaller than an adult common dacre. It's just pottering. Oh, just sitting on the side of the road. It's very dangerous. You better get a move on, otherwise you could find yourself as the next meal of a leopard. We wouldn't want that. Off it goes, pottering along. Bye-bye, little common dacre. I hope you live to see another day. Now, everybody, we've had no more luck with the lions. I think we're going to let the Nkuhumas, wherever they may be, have a restful evening, and hopefully they catch us something tomorrow night. And the Birminghams, hopefully they make an appearance again. And it's been a... Oh, hang on. I can still hear that male calling. He definitely sounds like he's just north of us. But possibly he's going to make his way back towards the ladies. So I hope you all have had a wonderful evening with us. Lots of excitement with all the lions, from the lions in the Mara to the lions here. And I hope you all have a wonderful night's rest as well. So cheerio from myself and Zanda, and thanks to the ladies in FC again in Final Control. But I think we're going to go back to Jamie, and I know she'd love to say goodbye to all of you. We'll see you tomorrow afternoon.
I've just stopped dead in my tracks to listen to the male lion roaring, what sounds like just off the property. Well, as Taylor said, we're going to have to give it another go tomorrow evening, but I do hope you've enjoyed your extended sunset safari and our adventures into the night. It's been an absolute blast. Thank you to Dave for his fantastic camera work, as always, as well as to our lovely ladies in Final Control. And a big thank you to all of you watching across the globe. We will catch up with you tomorrow for another extended sunset safari tomorrow evening, and who knows what this one might hold. I'm keeping my fingers crossed for a leopard personally, but we'll just have to see where the bush takes us tomorrow. Bye-bye everybody, and enjoy your last few moments in the Mara.
Everyone, we're going to sit here for another few minutes with these lions, but basically we're going to call it quits for the evening. We're going to head back up to Ngama Mara, the most magnificent lodge in all the world, possibly, and there we shall recline, much like these lions are doing right now. Tomorrow night, of course, we will be out, and we're probably going to push it a little bit longer. We may do a bit more darting between the prides and see if they don't kill, especially as they all seem to have killed today. And perhaps tomorrow night they'll be a little bit hungrier. The Kitratembo pride certainly didn't kill an adult. They killed a very small animal earlier today, and so maybe they'll be hungry. Maybe they'll come back to this area. Maybe that female lion that we had the other day with Morana there will be back. Who knows? We don't know what's going to happen. Anyway, from the Mara Triangle, that is going to be it from us for the day. It's been a magnificent day of much death and mayhem, but also much beauty, much beautiful, beautiful scenery, the incredible stories of the migration being told before us by the earth as those incredible animals went to and fro across the river, and unfortunately many of them, well, they found a new home in the deep, but many have made it away. Anyway, that's going to be it from us. Thank you very much for watching. A big thanks to Jandre and Graham and Emily in the back, to Daniel down here, and of course to the whole crew there in the Sabi Sands. We will see you tomorrow at, 4 o'clock East African time, 3 o'clock Central African time, and we'll push it, hopefully, with a lion kill live. Bye-bye.